William Morrow and Harper Audio present The Operator, a novel by Gretchen Berg, performed by Allyson Ryan. Chapter 1. December 15th, 1952. Vivian Dalton's worn old ankle boots crunched over the packed snow in front of Friedlander's, the bright lights of the department store spilling right out onto the sidewalk and mixing with the glow of the street lamps. Vivian gave a quick, polite wave of a gloved hand to Betty Miller, who'd caught her eye through the flocked glass of the main display window. Friedlander's fancied itself right up for the holidays, with the lights and the bells, and whatever it was they put on the window to make it look like it snowed inside. Vivian had heard it called flocked glass, but couldn't tell you what flocked was. She might have guessed something to do with geese. Flock, flocked, who knew? Vivian just knew she would have liked to be inside the bright store, on the other side of that flocked glass, herself, all nice and toasty, instead of out freezing her toes off, walking to work in the boots that might as well have been made of saran wrap for all the good they were doing. Betty Miller didn't have to work, did she? No, she was nice and toasty inside the department store with her two youngest, little Biddy and Charles Jr., waiting in the long line to see Santa Claus. And that didn't surprise Vivian one bit. This year Santa was a pretty good one, Vivian had to admit. Fat, jolly, and sober, at least, so the Millers were there, and the lines were much longer than they had been last year. Last year, Jimmy Hickson had said Santa's breath smelled like the Sunoco filling station. Jimmy's older brother Albert worked at the filling station, so he would know. When she'd heard what Jimmy Hickson said, Betty Miller had been the first mother to boycott the Santa line, and the other mothers quickly followed her lead, like they always did. She hadn't bothered with a courtesy phone call, politely explaining to Friedlander's with all her over-enunciated consonants, "Your Santa Claus seems to be frightfully embalmed." That would have taken up too much of her time. Vivian didn't know exactly what it was Betty did with her time, but she knew Betty thought her time was more precious than anyone else's. Betty Miller knew the boycott would work, and the other mothers knew it, and soon Friedlander's knew they'd better get themselves a new Santa Claus. No matter what little Biddy and Charles Jr. said to sober Santa, up there on his shiny red North Pole throne, Vivian Dalton knew the Millers were going to have a marvelous Christmas this year. The Millers had a marvelous Christmas every year. That was the thing about small towns. Everyone knew everyone else's business. Vivian certainly knew everyone else's business, but more important, she knew people. Vivian Dalton knew people, that was for certain, and she'd be the first to tell you that. She'd say it was more from intuition than from eavesdropping on people's telephone calls. But her daughter, Charlotte, would say, "No, it's from the eavesdropping." Charlotte joked with her friends, putting on airs for amusement, saying her mother was privy to myriad conversations among the good people of Worcester. Now, privy and myriad were two words Vivian would have used if she'd known what they meant. She wasn't stupid, but her schooling hadn't gone any further than grade 8 at Bowman Street School. Vivian never would have seen privy and myriad printed next to the splashy photos in her fashion and movie magazines. Charlotte had to roll her eyes and sigh as she explained to her friends, "My mother doesn't trust people who read books." It was a shame Vivian didn't know words like privy and myriad, because she would have loved them. They sounded fancy and expensive. They sounded like words the four flushers on the north side of Worcester probably used all the time, even at Bueller's when they were buying whatever it was they bought there, their prime rib and lobster claws and bushels of caviar or whatnot. Vivian eavesdropped and also did her share of peering into people's shopping carts at the grocery store. Yes, people like the Millers probably used words like privy and myriad at Bueller's. All four of their rich kids probably privied and myriaded all over the place. Little Biddy and Charles Jr. probably used those words when they were talking to sober Santa at Friedlander's. Vivian wasn't thinking about the words she didn't know as she crunched along on her way to work, blowing out little frozen clouds as she exhaled. She was thinking about how glad she was that Betty Miller had seen her wearing her new hat. There'd only been one left at Beulah Bechtel's that afternoon, and Vivian had set it on the counter next to the cash register, with shaky, guilty fingers that really should have been pushing the hat money across the counter to the bank teller to put into her savings account instead. She'd seen Betty hovering near the fur coats, eyeing the hat hungrily, looking at it like she'd almost eat it for lunch if she could, with her pointy little white teeth. Betty Miller's teeth weren't really pointy. That's just how Vivian imagined them. Pointy teeth and a vicious mouth that seemed just as likely to tear the very flesh from your bones as it was to smile and comment on the weather. Vivian had saved for months to buy that hat. Just that one hat. The beautiful hat that she knew hadn't really been made for someone like her. But maybe, if she bought that hat for herself, she'd feel a little bit of what the four flushers felt. Worthy of something nice. Boy, if she told Edward how much it cost, he would have put her in the lunatic asylum. Betty Miller probably could have bought four or five of those hats that day, right there. If they'd had any more, that is. You're lucky, the sales girl, Doris maybe, had said to Vivian as she wrapped the hat in lavender tissue paper. This is our last one. Vivian, in her worn-out ankle boots but fancy new hat, stepped out of the frigid night air and into the brick building, pulling the door closed behind her with a brrr before making her way to the cloakroom. She shrugged out of her coat and then carefully removed the beautiful new hat. Doris at Beulah Bechtel's had said it was Prussian blue, but Vivian didn't know what that was. She thought it looked more like a dark navy. Beulah hired girls from the college, and Doris probably went there to study Prussian or something. Either way, the blue complimented Vivian's eyes, and she especially liked how the hat dipped low over her right eyebrow on the one side. Chic, she'd read in her fashion magazines, pronouncing it chic in her head. She carefully balanced the hat on top of her old winter coat on one of the hooks in the cloakroom, and then trod over the worn wooden floors into the switchboard room, pulled out her rolling chair, and rolled herself back up to the counter to put on her headset. "Who takes a wife?" she asked Dorothy Hoffman, who was already seated, and probably had been for 15 minutes. "What?" Dorothy pushed the earpiece into her hair behind her ear, turning to face Vivian. "Who takes a wife in The Farmer and the Dell? Who takes a wife? Is it the sheep?" "The sheep?" Dorothy's penciled eyebrows furrowed into a jagged M on her pale forehead. "No?" Vivian asked, studying Dorothy's eyebrows. She should have been using brown eyebrow pencil instead of black. Black made her look angry, and Dorothy was probably just a little annoyed, like she always was when Vivian was a little late and then talked about nursery rhymes. "Why would the sheep take a wife?"
"I don't know. For some reason, that's what stuck in my head. Something about the E sound."
She turned back to the blank board in front of her and studied it, head tilted to the side.
"The E takes a wife?"
"It's the farmer who takes a wife," Dorothy said, because even though she was annoyed, she couldn't let Vivian think the sheep took a wife.
"The farmer? Are you sure?"
Vivian turned back to Dorothy, the doubt plain on her face. It was a nursery rhyme, for Christ's sakes. Why couldn't the sheep take a wife?
"I don't even think there is a sheep in the rhyme. You're probably thinking of the cheese."
"The cheese?"
"Yes, honey, the cheese."
Vivian turned her attention back to the board, giving a vigorous shake to the dark barrel curls she'd carefully arranged to look like Betty Davis's in All About Eve.
Well, the goddamned cheese wouldn't take a wife, she muttered, then started to giggle at the image of two wedges of cheese in front of a pastor, one wearing a veil. It doesn't. Dorothy looked skyward for help, like she did sometimes. The cheese stands alone. The cheese stands alone. The cheese stands alone. Dorothy sang the words as she held her hand over the mouthpiece. Every once in a while, there'd be a short in the wiring circuits, and even if the operator remembered to flip the muting switch, you could still hear her voice over the active line. Dorothy had learned her lesson about the wire glitches the hard way, and was now extra careful to flip the muting switch and cover her mouthpiece when talking to the other girls in the switchboard room. Worcester's very own mayor had overheard her say the F word, and that had gotten her suspended for 2 weeks without pay. Vivian never said the F word, but she said all the other ones, and was careful to keep her hand over the mouthpiece when she talked to the other girls in the room. Vivian frowned at the board for a moment, back to thinking of that cheese standing alone. She could see it, a wedge of holy Swiss cheese lit up by a stage spotlight, all by itself in the middle of her dining room table. Alone cheese, spinster cheese. Suddenly, one of the board's lights blinked before her. She quickly plugged the rear key cord into the jack, flipped the switch, and adjusted her own mouthpiece. Number, please. Vivian was a little bothered by the cheese standing alone in its spotlight, so she connected the call and flipped the mute switch. If she hadn't been distracted, she'd have listened in. You can learn a lot that way, she told Edward on one of their first dates. Even though they weren't supposed to, Vivian and the other girls who sat at the switchboards of Ohio Bell on East Liberty Street listened in on the telephone calls. Each and every day, they plugged their cords into the jacks, flipped their switches, and leaned into their headsets to find out what was going on around Worcester. You might say they were the ears of the town. If it were up to Vivian, they'd be a lot more than just that. She'd tell you she had a real sharp understanding of people and their personalities, and listening in at Bell only helped that along. She could tell you plenty about situations based on just a few details. For example, when Ray Barnes telephoned his mother from New York City to say he had a big surprise in store for her, Vivian knew that big surprise was a new fiancé. And she also knew that Mrs. Barnes wasn't going to like that one bit. Probably with good reason, if she were honest with you. That fiancé was likely a no-good slut. The good girls went to New York City from the small towns, not the other way around. Ruth Craven had listened in the day Ray Barnes's mother called her sister in Mansfield to complain about the fast New York City girl Raymond brought home and how she was corrupting her poor, innocent boy. The Negro music he listens to now. Ruth was good enough to tell the other switchboard girls all about it and remind them about what Vivian had said. Some of them liked to tease her when she talked about knowing people, but they all looked at her with just a little more respect after that call. You don't need some fancy college degree or even a regular old high school diploma to know people, she'd say. Lately, there'd been almost nothing to know about anyone. Vivian had just about fallen asleep at the console a few times. The townspeople of Worcester were talking about the dullest things you could imagine. Take this week. On Monday, Mrs. Butler complained to Mrs. Young that her daughter Maxine never called anymore, and even after she'd sent Maxine that beautiful windmill star quilt she'd worked so hard on. On Tuesday, Earl Archer called his wife Dora from the ticket office at the railroad depot because he'd left his wallet on their kitchen counter again and wanted her to please get on the bus and bring it to him. On Wednesday, Clyde Walsh called Ginny Frazier to ask if she'd go to the A&W with him that afternoon after he finished shoveling the sidewalk in front of his mother's house. And Ginny Frazier, for the upteenth time, said no. Vivian had connected all these calls, and although they were dull, she'd listened in and made up her mind about them. She thought Mrs. Butler should drive herself down to Columbus, break into Maxine's house, and take that quilt back. She thought Earl should hustle his wrinkled old ass back to the house, rather than making Dora take the bus in this cold weather just because he was a careless, absent-minded idiot. And she thought Ginny Frazier might want to think long and hard about her chances of doing better than Clyde Walsh. If he could overlook that frying pan face of hers, he was worth a hamburger and root beer float at the A&W. How many boys his age still shoveled the walk for their mothers?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.